So what we are saying here is that in one case we have relation for effectiveness in terms of ratio of specific heats and NTU, and in the other we are saying that NTU is a function of epsilon and C. That is what, if I write it for NTU, what method it is? What method it is? If I write equation for NTU, epsilon is a function of temperatures. So if I know inlet and outlet all temperatures, I know effectiveness, I know C. So NTU, that means NTU approach, if I write in equation for NTU, actually it is LMTD approach, is not it? It is LMTD approach. Why? Because epsilon is having one of the outlet temperatures, remember that. So if I, so what that is what professor was trying to say, if you have epsilon NTU, you can get LMTD approach also. From LMTD, how can you get to NTU approach? We will see that little later on. Okay. So now let us quickly take the figures and tell, you want to add some, you let us take one of these figures. Okay. So what is this figure telling me? What is this figure telling me? I am taking a parallel flow heat exchanger, and before I go to the parallel flow heat exchanger, let me take all heat exchangers in one. This is the mother of all figures actually. So this is effectiveness, effectiveness and NTU. So this is effectiveness is on the y axis and NTU is on the x axis. Now if the this plot has been shown for C equal to 1, that is ratio of the specific heats equal to 1, that is mass flow rates into specific heat of hot equal to mass flow rate and specific heat of the cold. You see here, this is the point I was trying to strike. Effectiveness for parallel flow is very less, and effectiveness of counter flow is very high, and it is counter flow, you see it is increasing with the increase of NTU, but for parallel flow it becomes constant after certain NTU. We do not gain much by increasing the area in parallel flow heat exchanger, that is what it means in case of parallel flow. But all other heat exchangers which we are going to build are going to be in between these two. Here we have just plotted cross flow with both fluids unmixed. You plot any other heat exchanger, they are going to lie in between these two. That is the crux, that is the crux, that is the reason why in any heat transfer textbook or any heat transfer teacher is going to teach us only parallel and counter flow. Why? Because once you know counter flow, you know that is the best, and once you know parallel flow, that is the worst. Okay. So having understood this concept, now let us take up, now let us take up any heat exchanger, let us take up any heat exchanger. What is happening here? For a, if C equal to 1, this is effectiveness, this is NTU, I have just taken parallel flow. What is happening with the decrease of C? What is happening with the decrease of C? C is with the decrease of C min by C maximum, this ratio is C min by C maximum. When C min by C maximum equal to 1, it is very low. When C min by C maximum equal to 0, it is very high. Why for C min by C maximum it is very, Z equal to 0, it is very high? What is that heat exchanger actually? In which case C min by C maximum equal to 0? Two phase flow heat exchanger, that is. That means on one side the heat transfer coefficient is extremely high, either HI or HO. Why? Because it is two phase. So C maximum is infinite, that is, that is what we took, no? There is no temperature gradient. For that case where there is no temperature gradient, where the heat transfer is taking place thoroughly by latent heat, then we have C min by C maximum equal to 0, that is where we have maximum heat transfer. Naturally two phase flow heat exchangers are more effective than the single phase heat exchanger. For a given NTU, if I go on decreasing C min by C maximum, I am going, this is like going from single phase to two phase flow heat exchanger. That is the reason why effectiveness is increasing, and the ultimate limit is this. Why? Because this is two phase flow heat exchanger. Okay. So that is another reasoning what one can give, and this pattern is true for any counter flow you take, this is true. Okay. And you take shell and tube heat exchanger, this is true, and you take any other heat exchanger, you are going to get the same pattern. So these are the points which we need to emphasize, and C equal to 0, effectiveness is equal to 1 minus of e to the power of minus 1 TU, NTU. This is what I have told. If C equal to 0, C max tends to infinity, that is what is going to get for condenser and boiler. That is the case that is here, what I had shown for C min by C maximum equal to 0. Okay? So, with that we will move on to, if C is equal to 1, effectiveness is the lowest. So, we should, the point is we should try to avoid the keep the same products, we should try to avoid, there should be the difference. Okay. That is because that will create more temperature difference, that is other way of looking at it. It will create more temperature difference, that is what Professor Arun was insisting. If you create more temperature difference, there will be more heat transfer. You can create more temperature difference by having more difference in the mass flow rates and specific heats. Okay. So, that is what is being mentioned here in all of these transparencies, whatever I told, and these are the equations which are given, which you can, all these derivations are given in Case and London for all the cases. If someone is interested in these derivations, they can go back and derive from fundamentals. But definitely for a UG, parallel and counter flow, one has to do. And these are problems, I am not going to solve any of these problems. I would request you to sit down and solve these problems. They are all simple plug-in type problems. And all that I want to tell, only two more points I will tell and sign off from this, is that one is, can I use LMTD for NTU approach? That means, if I know the can I use LMTD approach for NTU? That means, for a given heat exchanger and inlet temperatures known, can I compute the area using LMTD approach? Can I compute? Yes. How?
Yes.
Here my student says, yes, we can do, and he says that we can do it iteratively. What he is saying is that, if I have a parallel flow heat exchanger, I have to take elemental small DASs. And for each elemental area, you apply LMTD approach. You apply LMTD approach, and then you can go that way and compute the area at the exit at which your TH naught is equal to the TH naught what has been given in the problem. So, LMTD piecewise, if you do, you can apply it for even NTU approach. So, earlier days, when LMTD approach was found, there was no computer, they had to manage with simple graphs. That is why Case and London came up with that NTU approach. In today's world, both the approaches, for all practical purposes, they are same. There is nothing different. In real life heat exchanger design, people simply go ahead with either LMTD or NTU based on the convenience. Approach is not a major issue, because in today's computer, either you will write a MATLAB code or an Excel sheet calculation, wherein which you will take a small strip and go on, strips, and you will go on integrating them. So, it does not matter whether you are using epsilon NTU approach or LMTD approach. That is another thing, that is one point. Another point what I want to emphasize is, which we did not emphasize, is the pumping power. Heat transfer, heat exchanger is not designed on the basis of only heat transfer coefficient. So, in the problem, in one of the problems I said oil, I said you put a pump, but pump does not come just like that free, especially if I have to design, if I have to decide a pump and fix a pump, that pumping power will be in kilowatts or even megawatts. Okay? So, if that is in a condenser, I have seen in Tarapur nuclear power plant, condenser which we usually neglect in thermodynamics, condenser power is very less, we neglect, but that is actually around 5 to 10 megawatts in Tarapur nuclear power plant, and that is as big as our mechanical engineering building, that is 3-story building. What they mean in thermodynamics is, when we neglect that pumping power of condenser is compared to the power you generate in the complete power plant, which is of the order of 800 or 900 megawatt. Compared to 800-900 megawatts, you can probably neglect that 3 or 5 megawatt. But 3 or 5 megawatts, just like that, it won't come, you have to build it. So, when you are designing a condenser, you have to be worried about the pumping power also. So, however small it is, pumping power makes lot of influence. That is why in the design of heat exchanger, always the quest is for increasing the heat transfer coefficient and decreasing the pumping power. And it is not easy to come by, nothing comes easy, you have to spend something, I mean nothing comes free, you have to spend something. The heat transfer coefficient always increases with the increase of friction factor or the pumping power, not as much as the, as much as you increase the pumping power. In fact, the increase in heat transfer coefficient is always lesser than the pumping power you spend. Okay? So, with this, I think we will come to end of heat exchanger, and I know there are a lot of questions, but I need to wait for questions. What I will do is next, or we will take some questions. No, in next 15-20 minutes, I had postponed yesterday in radiation. See, we had found that emissivity of non-conductor, I am switching gears and coming to radiation, that is number one. Number two, I had promised that even in coordinators workshop that we will try to understand through electromagnetic wave theory, we will try to understand and explain why emissivities are, how are they, why non-conductor emissivity is greater than conductor emissivity. One of the questions from Anna University also was there, I am sure all of you will have this question, why emissivity of a non-conductor is higher than the emissivity of a conductor, number one, and how does emissivity vary with temperature. So, it is very difficult to answer these questions until I take the recourse of electromagnetic wave theory. So, here in next half an hour, I do not pretend that I have understood everything of this. I am just trying to see how in a very simplistic fashion, take the laws which are available in light and electromagnetism. I will just state those laws, I am not going to derive them. By stating those laws, how can I compute reflectivity? From reflectivity, how can I compute emissivity, from which I can infer absorptivity? So, these are the questions for I will do for conductor and a non-conductor, and that too I will do it for non-magnetic material. If you take a magnetic material, things are going to be complicated. In which way they are going to be complicated, I will let you know as we go along. So, next half an hour, I want all of you to write equations what I am writing here, including you. I want all of you to write the equations along with me. They are not very lengthy, but why I am saying you need to write with me, because you will be comfortable when you write these equations along with me. Okay. So, let me get started. Okay. So, what am I saying is, electromagnetic wave theory, that is what is the heading, you can write if you want to write in your notes. What is that we are saying is, there is complex index of refraction, complex index of refraction. Refraction, not reflection, refraction, that is m equal to n minus I k, that is it is imaginary, n is real part, k is imaginary, it is a complex number, not imaginary, this is a complex form, this is a complex form. Let me, where n is refractive index, and k is absorptive index. Why it is negative? Because as an electromagnetic wave starts radiating through a medium, its energy is getting absorbed. That is why this negative sign is coming. That is m equal to n minus I k. Okay? Now, let me take two non-absorbing media, because I cannot take both the things, both complexities in one go. I will take two non-absorbing media. If I take an interface between two non-absorbing media, that means k is 0, I have only non-absorbing media. If I take non-absorbing media, okay, I have to move on to the next page. Okay. So, what do I get? This we have studied in plus 2, but still for the sake of completion, this is medium 1, which is having refractive index n 1. This is medium 2, which is having refractive index n 2. And I have chosen such that n 2 is greater than n 1. Okay? And now, if electromagnetic wave or light goes, we all know that this is the angle theta 1 with respect to normal, it undergoes refraction. We all have studied this, why spoon looks bent and all we have studied. So, I do not have to go to those examples for you. In plus 2 we have studied. So, this is theta 2, okay? This is theta 2, okay? This is theta 1, okay? So, what is Snell's law telling us? Snell's law was found, was stated in 1621. What did he say? He derived from fundamentals that n1 by n2 equal to sin theta 2 by sin theta 1, okay? Where theta 1 is angle of incidence and theta 2 is angle of refraction. Theta 1 is angle of incidence and theta 2 is angle of refraction, okay? Now, I got how I can relate the refractive indices. Now, next question is, from what are we looking for? We are trying to look for transmissivity, emissivity and absorptivity. Now, I will try to relate or from Maxwell's relation, that is by invoking Fresnel's relation. As I said, I am only stating these relations, I am not deriving them. Fresnel's relation, I get reflectivity as a function of thetas, that is tan squared theta 1 minus theta 2 upon tan squared theta 1 plus theta 2 plus sin squared theta 1 minus theta 2 upon sin squared theta 1 plus theta 2. Now, what is transmissivity? There is no absorptivity, okay? So, now transmissivity should be equal to 1 minus reflectivity, okay? In a non-absorbing medium, I can quantify now reflectivity and transmissivity, which is dependent on angle of incidence and angle of refraction, that gives me the refractive index. That means, this can be expressed in terms of refractive index also. It is not very difficult. For that, I have to invoke Brewster's law. Let me not do that. I am not going to do that. So, if we invoke Brewster's law, I can get this expression in terms of N1 and N2. For absorbing media, I am going to do that. Now, next is, let me take a, now let us get to real life. That is, let me take a case wherein which I have a medium. That is, we are interested in solid plate, na? Let me take a solid plate. That is, this is absorbing medium. I am taking this as absorbing medium. This is absorbing medium and this is air. Air, we all know, it is not having any absorptivity and refractive index is also equal to 1. That means, this is non-absorbing medium, air. From air, electromagnetic, that is what happens in all our applications of radiation. So, that is what I have taken. So, here for this absorbing medium, the index, complex index is given by m equal to n minus I k, where n is refractive index, k is absorptive index. So, again I have theta 1 and I have theta 2. This is theta 1. Now, without deriving, again I am going to state this, rho n lambda, that is reflectivity in the normal direction at a given wavelength lambda, is given by n minus 1 whole squared plus k squared upon n plus 1 whole squared plus k squared, okay? What I am trying to say is, without deriving, what I am trying to say is, reflectivity in a non-absorbing medium was a function of refractive index. In an absorbing and refractive medium, it is going to be function of refractive index and absorptive index. If I measure refractive index and absorptive index of every material, I should be able to compute the reflectivity. If it is, now how do I get, now if I take a solid plate, I said I am taking a solid plate. For a solid plate, what would be the transmissivity? It is opaque. It is opaque. If for a copper plate or a silver plate or an aluminium plate, that is what I am going to do calculations for. Silver plate, I am going to do the calculations, and I am going to do for silicon carbide, for magnesium oxide, I am going to do for reflectivity, and then show that non-conductor emissivity is higher than conductor emissivity. That means for a copper plate, transmissivity is 0. Transmissivity is 0. If transmissivity for a copper plate is 0, what will be my absorptivity? Absorptivity will be given by 1 minus reflectivity. This is for opaque medium. This is for opaque medium. Let us remember that. Now, I have to head for bigger equation. Now, how do I get this N and K? Next question is, how do I get this N and K? Who gives me this N and K? Who is going to decide this N and K, or which, what is it this N and K dependent upon? That is the question. That can be obtained from electrical permittivity and magnetic permeability. I am first, again we go always from simple to complex. I am taking a non-magnetic material. Please note my examples, what I told: silver, copper, aluminium, they are all non-ferrous, they are non-magnetic materials. That means my magnet cannot attract them. Okay? So, those non-magnetic materials will not have any magnetic permeability. So, in that case, for non-magnetic material, what am I up to? I am trying to figure out how can I predict N and K from electrical permeability or electrical permittivity. For non-magnetic material, N squared equal to half upon, little lengthy, you have to be patient, epsilon prime. This is not emissivity, this is permittivity, but primes we are using, please note that. It is not emissivity, do not get carried away. We have not reached emissivity yet, it is distant, plus square root of epsilon prime squared plus epsilon double prime squared. What is this epsilon prime? Okay, this is epsilon prime and this is epsilon double prime. Okay. What is epsilon prime given by? Epsilon prime equal to electrical permittivity. Do not worry, I will explain electrical permittivity also within a minute. For now, you take my word. Electrical permittivity in a given medium and electrical permittivity of that material in vacuum, that is epsilon naught. Okay? That is, let me write that. Epsilon prime, epsilon is electrical permittivity. Electrical permittivity. Okay? Epsilon naught is same electrical permittivity of the same material, but measured in vacuum. Okay? Now, epsilon double prime, what is this epsilon double prime dependent on? Epsilon double prime is given by sigma e lambda naught upon 2 pi c naught epsilon naught. In fact, if you can relate this N with earlier, already I have told N. Has this N come anywhere else earlier? C equal to C naught by N, I had told. That is refractive index. The same refractive index we are talking about here. Okay? So, now you can relate, why did I write C equal to C naught by N there? Okay? So, what is this sigma E? Sigma E is electrical conductivity. Medium's electrical conductivity. Okay? That is epsilon double prime. I think other things we can understand. What is lambda naught? Lambda naught is the wavelength of the electromagnetic wave in vacuum, and C naught is the velocity of light in vacuum 2.998 × 10⁸ meters per second. Epsilon naught already I have told. So, we know now epsilon prime and epsilon double prime. Still, if someone does not know electrical permittivity, let us go and understand that. Epsilon prime, okay. Question asked is by Professor Arun is, what is epsilon prime and what is epsilon double prime? Epsilon prime is a normalized electrical permittivity. That is electrical permittivity of a given material divided by electrical permittivity of the same material measured in vacuum. And what is epsilon double prime? It is a measure of electrical conductivity. It is a measure of electrical conductivity. That means electrical conductivity effects are this second term, and electrical permittivity is the first term. Okay? So, refractive index is a function of electrical permittivity and electrical conductivity. Now, let us see what is electrical permittivity. Okay? Getting bored? I do not know. Maybe it is, for me it is quite interesting because I am learning this for the first time. So, what is electrical permittivity? This we have studied in fact in electrostatics. Okay? When we have two charges, I am trying to define what is permittivity. If I have two charges and if they are, the distance between the two charges is R, the force Coulomb's law, force equal to the force between these two charges is equal to, which is having a charge Q1 and it is having a charge Q2, Q1, Q2 upon, you see what all laws we are invoking. We went to light, we went to electromagnetics, and now we are getting to electrostatics. We need everything. Whatever we study in plus 2, now only I am realizing, whatever we study in plus 2 is required for our lifetime. We cannot afford to forget. Everything is getting connected. Everything is one. We are the ones who have divided it because for the sake of learning. Okay? So, Q1, Q2 upon 4 pi epsilon r squared. Okay? Same Coulomb's law, if I apply in vacuum, if I do the same thing in vacuum, if not in a medium, the same Coulomb's law, if I apply, what should I get? A different force F naught, but what would be different? Q1, Q2, I have kept the same charges, okay? Same charge, that is 4 pi epsilon naught r square. This is F by F naught gives me what? What does F by F naught gives me? Epsilon by epsilon naught. Now, you would have understood how one would measure electrical, normalized electrical permittivity. Yeah, F by F naught is, okay, let me correct it this way, because I want epsilon by F naught by F, that is, this is F naught by F, if I do, I get epsilon by epsilon naught. Okay? So, in the previous thing, what did we say? There is electrical permittivity and there is electrical conductivity, that is N. Now, let me go ahead. If you are impatient, what are we doing? Let us calculate, go ahead and calculate for silver reflectivity, okay? So, what do we do? Let me take silver and let me choose a wavelength, because all properties, all these permittivity, electrical conductivity, electrical permittivity, all are functions of wavelength. Remember that. And temperature. Epsilon 6.2 and I take room temperature. So, epsilon naught equal to 3.4 for silver and epsilon prime is given by epsilon naught minus of nu p squared. I am giving a new relation. I am not using the old relation which I had put. Okay? Nu squared plus gamma squared. This is coming from, because this is given by different theory, Drude theory. This is what I am presenting, is a theory by name Drude theory. That is epsilon naught minus of nu p squared. What is nu p? nu p is the plasma frequency. Plasma frequency is the frequency with which the electron vibrates at cold conditions, that is plasma frequency. And gamma, so that is, what are we up to? We are up to calculating the n and k, and from n and k I am supposed to get the reflectivity, and from there I am supposed to get the emissivity. Okay, this I will do both for conductor and non-conductor, and I have taken in a conductor non-magnetic material. Why? Because I want to rule out magnetic permeability. So nu p gamma is called as oscillation damping factor. You do not have to worry if you are not understanding these things. There is a relation. So if this is 3.4 and nu p for silver is given to be 2.22 into 10 to the power of 5, and gamma is given to be 4.3 into 10 to the power of 12. How do I get nu? How do I get my nu? Who gives me nu? Nu equal to C naught by lambda, is not it? So, C naught by lambda, that is 2.998 into 10 to the power of 8. Lambda, do we know? Yes, we have taken a particular frequency, particular wavelength, 6.2 micrometers, 6.2 into 10 to the power of minus 6, I get nu equal to 4.84 into 10 to the power of 13 hertz, that is nu. If I substitute all of this, I get nu prime as minus 2084. This is nu prime. Okay. Next, I need epsilon double prime. This is nu prime. Okay. Now, I need epsilon double prime. Remember, in my, why am I doing this? I need n. N is a function of epsilon prime and epsilon double prime. I have calculated epsilon prime. I need epsilon. I have calculated epsilon single prime. I need epsilon double prime. Epsilon double prime is given by atomic frequency nu p squared gamma upon nu into gamma squared plus nu squared. If you substitute that, you get 185.1. And remember, we had got epsilon prime as minus 2084. What is n? N squared equal to half into epsilon prime plus epsilon prime squared plus epsilon double prime whole squared. If I substitute these values, I get n squared as 4.1, n equal to 2.03. Similarly, k squared equal to half into epsilon prime plus square root of minus, this is minus, epsilon prime whole squared plus epsilon double prime whole squared equal to, I get 2088, that means I get a k of 45.7. That means I have got refractive index as 2.03 and absorptive index as 45.3. Having got, what is that next thing to get? I have to get the reflectivity. Normal reflectivity, I have already given this relation if I am right. Did I give this relation? N minus 1, I have given already. For an absorbing medium, I gave you this relation. N minus 1 whole squared plus k squared upon n plus 1 whole squared plus k squared. That is what I am going to invoke now. That is n minus 1 whole squared plus k squared upon n plus 1 whole squared plus k squared. This is plus, note, this is plus and this is minus. So, if I substitute this n here and k here, I am going to get rho n lambda as 0.996. You see, reflectivity is so high. What is absorptivity? Transmissivity is 0. So, absorptivity is equal to emissivity is equal to, at the same temperature, when I write that, it is at the same temperature, it is equal to 1 minus rho n lambda, that is equal to 0.004. How do I know that whether my reflectivity calculation is right or wrong? Experimental rho n lambda, experimental is 0.98. Okay? So our theory has now, electromagnetic wave theory has now given us a calculation for reflectivity. So what is that, why is the conductor's emissivity less? Because typically reflectivity of a conductor is high. Now let us do the same calculation for, summary is high reflectance because of which emissivity is less for conductors. That is what we understood now. Okay. Now let us do the same thing for, let us do the same thing for a non-conductor. Let me take a non-conductor. What is a non-conductor I am taking? The non-conductor I am taking here is, I am taking a non-conductor, let us say either silica, let us take silica or magnesium oxide. Each one's refractive index is 3.41 and 1.7 for a wavelength range of 3 to 10 micrometer for silica and 1 to 10 micrometer for magnesium oxide. Now, what is the reflectivity? Reflectivity we have already given, n minus 1 whole squared plus k squared upon n plus 1 whole squared plus k squared. It so happens that for non-conductors, the k is very, very less. We can neglect k for non-conductors. That is, it is absorptive index is 0. That means there is no absorption taking place in non-conductor. Okay? Why? Because there are no free electrons. I think I am not answering it. I really do not know why the absorptivity is, why the absorptive index is less for non-conductors. Yes, let me not go overboard and answer that. But it is experimentally observed that absorptivity index of non-conductors is very less. If the absorptivity is taken as 0 and if I take n for silica, what do I get? For silica, I get rho n lambda, for silica I get as 0.7 and for magnesium oxide I get 0.07. What is the emissivity for silica? I get it as 0.7, sorry, this is 0.3 and emissivity is 0.7. That is, emissivity of silica is 0.7 and emissivity of magnesium oxide is 0.93. Can you see now? Reflectance is for non-conductors, it is very, reflectance is less, very less, because of which emissivity is high. Low reflectance for non-conductors is the reason for high emissivity for non-conductors. That is the only way. Had I not taken the recourse of electromagnetic wave theory, I could not have answered your question, why is the emissivity of a non-conductor higher than the emissivity of a conductor? Okay? That is the one question I have answered. Okay? So now, if magnetic material is there, what will happen? I will just take only 5 more minutes on this issue. On magnetic material is there, what will happen? If there is a magnetic material, m continues to be n minus ik, no doubt about that, but n and k are going to be functions of both electrical permittivity and magnetic permittivity, magnetic permeability. N squared minus k squared equal to epsilon mu c naught squared n k equal to sigma e mu lambda naught c naught upon 4 pi. What is mu? What is mu? Mu is magnetic permeability. Magnetic permeability. Okay? That is mu, and this is epsilon, please, epsilon, epsilon we know now, it is electrical permittivity, and sigma e is, what is sigma e? What is sigma e? Electrical conductivity, we have told that, and c naught is the velocity of the electromagnetic wave in vacuum, and lambda naught is the wavelength in vacuum. Oh, okay? So, what it means is that n and k are dependent both on electrical permittivity, magnetic permeability and electrical conductivity. Okay? Three parameters, n and k are functions of electrical permittivity, magnetic permeability and electrical conductivity. So, these three properties decide my N and K, which in turn decide my reflectivity, which in turn decides my emissivity. Okay? That is all we have shown. I know I have not derived any relations. All basic laws from optics and electromagnetic wave theory I have straight lifted and presented here. This is a very, what to say, very humble attempt just to explain how emissivities vary or how difficult it is to explain the emissivity variations with emissivity, with wavelength, with temperature and with material. Okay? So, what I would suggest to you is, why do not you go ahead and calculate, why do not you go ahead in the same lines what I have done, why do not you please calculate yourself, so that if you do the calculation once, you will be comfortable. Why do not you calculate once for two other materials? That is, homework what I am giving on this is, it is not hear and forget. I want you to calculate, that is for aluminium and copper, nu p is 3.07 plasma frequency, copper is 2.25 hertz, gamma oscillation damping factor 31.2 4.55, epsilon experimental is, no, this is reflectivity is 0.99 for aluminum experimental and 0.97. when you calculate, you will get the values closer to this. Okay? So, why do not you, and you calculate this at the same lambda, 6.2 micrometer and room temperature. Of course, temperature is not coming into picture anywhere, but all these nu p, gamma, rho are all going to be, nu p and gamma are going to be functions of temperature and wavelength. Okay? This is the homework which you are going to take for calculating nu. Okay? One last word before I sign off on this electromagnetic wave theory business is, how is emissivity going to be a function of temperature? Okay? Emissivity is found to be function of temperature in this format, 0.776 T upon sigma e to the power of half minus of bracket open 0.309 minus of, here I am writing, 0.089 log of T by sigma e bracket closed into T by sigma e minus of 0.0175 T upon sigma e to the power of 3/2. Okay? Typically, okay, here, yeah. Okay? So, now it becomes complex. What is that? Nothing complex. All that we are saying is, emissivity should increase with temperature at one point. That is one thing. At the same time, there is a dependence on, what is this sigma e? Electrical conductivity. Temperature, with the increase of temperature, electrical conductivity decreases, at least for metals. Okay? So, emissivity increases with the increase of temperature at one point, and electrical conductivity decreases with the increase of the temperature. So, it is the interplay between these two for different materials, which decides whether emissivity increases or decreases with the temperature. In most of our graphs, in emissivity with temperature, somewhere it was increasing, somewhere it was decreasing. That is because of the interplay between the temperature and the electrical conductivity. This is a, whatever I have taught now is not complete answer for all the questions. This is an humble attempt just to give the feel how difficult it is to explain the emissivity, absorptivity, transmissivity, reflectivity, property variations with temperature and material. That is all. It is just an humble attempt. Do not take this, what to say, to the T. Means, it will differ for different materials. It is restricted to the assumptions which for which they are derived for. Each law is derived for. Okay, that's what. With that, I think we will move on to next half an hour is for question answers. We will spend time on question answers. VNIT Nagpur.
In the topic heat exchangers, the you have considered while solving the numerical, the hot fluid is flowing through the tube and cold fluid is flowing over the tube. And if the situation is reversed, if the cold fluid is flowing through the tube and over the tube the hot fluid is flowing, what change in the heat transfer will be occurring and by what means that is occurring?
Okay. See, you can sit down and calculate, no? See, if I change, flip hot and cold side, what will it change? What will it change? Yes? If I take the problem, in principle, you can sit down and do that. I can say that you please do it yourself, but I will not do that. Let me attempt to answer that question. Let me go to the numerical and think aloud. The question asked is, in the numerical which is solved, one fluid, cold fluid, I do not remember, the cold fluid is flowing one side and hot fluid is flowing on the other side. If I flip them, that is in this problem, hot fluid is flowing on the annulus, that is the shell side, and cold fluid is flowing in the tube side. What change I will get? What change I will get if I flip these two fluids? Properties, no property change, properties should be same, and Reynolds number should be different. Reynolds number should be different. What will happen? Nothing will happen in principle. You will more or less get the same numbers. That is, HI again will tend to become laminar in the tube side, and HO on the outer side will be turbulent only. So, in principle, you will be ending up, of course, the length would be slightly different. This length would be slightly different because HI and HO will get slightly differed, but in principle, length will be of the same order. Is that okay, professor?
Well, okay, sir, okay.
If you put hot fluid on the outside, then your insulation has to be far better.
Correct.
Right. That is why you tend to put wherever possible cold fluid on the outside, because heat is going from hot to cold.
Correct.
Now, if I put hot fluid on the outside, it has to go into the cold and also it will escape out radially. Okay. So, it will go in two directions, okay, outward radial, inward radial.
It is not cold really, it is 30. So, it is near ambient condition. Okay.
Sir, helical coil is arranged in a shell. Through the coil, hot water is flowing, and over the coil, cold water is flowing. That is in the shell.
Okay.
What change in the heat transfer will be occurring if the situation of flow of the two fluids is reversed?
Okay. I will not. Question is, I have a helical coil immersed in shell and tube heat exchanger, shell and tube. On shell side, one fluid flows, cold fluid. On tube side, hot fluid flows. Now, what change it would occur if I flip this? Whatever change I explained it to you for the example, whatever I quoted, same effect would be there here also. So, there is no change. So, I would request you to sit down and do the calculation for the numerical what I have done. You will appreciate the answer for this problem. I know you are not happy with my answer, but that is the answer.
Other thing is that probably fouling effects will come in. Okay, so when fouling effects come in, you will have to think of how to clean them off. So, based on that consideration also, you will put which fluid goes in, which fluid goes out.
But that is
secondary.
Yeah. Basically, there is not much of a difference in terms of concept in applying things.
Yeah.
Okay. JNTU Hyderabad.
Sir, in gas turbine cooling techniques, what is meant by film cooling and what is meant by impingement cooling? That is my first question. And the next question is, out of these two, which one will give the better heat transfer coefficient?
Actually, this question has been asked in the mode. Question is, in gas turbine blade cooling, what is jet impingement cooling, what is film cooling? Professor, I have answered this in great detail in Moodle. In fact, jet impingement cooling gives you the higher heat transfer coefficient compared to film cooling. There is no now doubt about it because jet is impinging directly. Film cooling is like cooling potato. I have taken this example already. We cool the potato while peeling the potato by keeping the potato under water by making a film of cold water around potato. That is what we do in gas turbine blade also. Out of these two, jet impingement heat transfer is the most effective one. So, much more detailed way I have answered this in Moodle already. There are around 5 to 6 replies for this question. Okay, professor, any other questions please?
Fouling factor, what is the maximum range of fouling factor in heat exchanger? How it affect with respect to heat transfer or heat transfer coefficient?
Okay, question is, what is fouling factor? How does it vary from heat exchanger to heat exchanger? And how does it affect the heat exchanger or the heat exchanger
heat transfer coefficient?
Okay. So, first let us take the second question, that is, how does the heat transfer coefficient get affected by the fouling? Yes, surface is getting roughened, so heat transfer coefficient is going to get, we tend to think that heat transfer coefficient may increase, but my pumping power is same. So, my velocity may decrease with the passage of time because of the fouling, because of my pumping power has decreased, but at the same time cross sectional area also has decreased. So, velocity might increase also. So, generally the velocity increase and the pumping power are not going to affect so much, but the heat transfer coefficient, there might be a slight increase, or we can conveniently say that heat transfer coefficient may not get affected that much, but what gets affected is the fouling resistance. There is an additional resistance which is coming into picture. One more interface has been created on the wall. So, there is an additional resistance because of which my load will come down. My load will come down. That is, my overall heat transfer coefficient will come down, my resistance will go up, because of which my load, if it is designed for 100 megawatts, it may work only for 98 megawatts the second year or third year. Okay. So, how does one measure how do we get the fouling resistance? It is done by measurement only. They do some accelerated experiments, that is, you increase the concentrations, of those salts and do an accelerated experiment. That means, by increasing the concentrations of the materials or the chemicals which are responsible for fouling, you increase the concentrations so that whatever fouling would have occurred in 1 year, you would have perhaps in the lab done in 1 day. Okay? That scaling you do in terms of time by increasing the concentrations of the chemicals responsible for fouling, and that is how one measures the fouling resistance. Otherwise, in real life industry, one cannot go and measure fouling resistance. It's just not possible. Okay.
PG stove, burner, circular holes. If we make elliptical holes, will there be any heat transfer? The change.
Question is, in my LPG LPG burner, instead of circular holes, will I make elliptical holes? Okay, that is one PhD. Okay, no problem. But usually, how does the holes, here my student is sitting, Samir, who is doing the experiments on jet impingement with various shapes of holes. Usually, people are going for non-circular holes only when noise is an issue, especially for compressible jets. That is, if we take a non-circular hole, especially elliptical one creates lesser noise. So, acoustics is the one which is driving us for choosing, even in a combustor, what, gas turbine blade combustor, the elliptical hole, or even if you have to go for high speed jet flame jets. In my burner which is there, which is being used at home, they are not compressible jets, they are incompressible jets. Okay? They are not compressible, that means Mach numbers are not exceeding Mach number greater than 0.3. Reynolds numbers, if we sit down and calculate, they may be around 5000 to 10000. They are turbulent, but they are not compressible. So, I do not see great advantage by going for elliptical holes or burner geometry. But if we are talking about high compressible jets, which is the case in case of gas turbine blade, people are not only going for elliptical, but they are also trying non-circular, that is triangular, rectangular and other weird shapes, but not from thermal aspect, but from acoustics aspect. Okay.
Now, one more question, sir. Why radiation is completely neglected in design of a heat exchanger? I think radiation also plays a little role in heat transfer. Yes. Over to you, sir.
Yes. One of the very good question is, radiation is usually in the classrooms is completely neglected in the heat exchangers. Radiation is little important, that is the question. Yes, radiation is very important. We cannot neglect, especially when I am operating, when I am handling high temperature heat exchangers. But in the resistance within tube in tube, if I take, where is radiation becoming important? Radiation is becoming important while computing the heat loss from the outer side of the heat exchanger. But between the two fluids where the wall is there, what is the mode of the heat transfer one can think of? It is conduction and convection. Now, fluids are non-participating medium, that is why there is no radiation. But where is radiation is there? Radiation is there on the outer wall where it is talking to the atmosphere, that is which is deciding the heat loss. That is wherever we are assuming that there is no heat loss in my heat exchanger, that assumption has to be relaxed and taken into account. But otherwise, in computing the areas, I do not think we need to take into account the radiation at all. But radiation is important, but it is only in computing the losses. I think we are moving away from this center because we have taken three questions. We will go to MANIT Bhopal.
First is how the temperature distribution varies with length in case of cross flow heat exchanger.
This is a very specific.
You have demonstrated for parallel flow and counter flow heat exchanger.
Yeah, that is what I said. See, the question is, it is neither a cross flow, sorry, neither a parallel flow nor a counter flow. Okay. So, it is very difficult to plot the temperature plot. Let me go ahead, and one point I have missed. I need to understand one point and tell you, is this plot always like this? See, I take parallel and counter flow heat exchanger always like this. I always write a plot always like this, okay? And for counter flow, I always draw like this. Is it going to be always like this? Can my profile for a parallel flow be like this and be like this? Can it be like this? Yes, it can be. Can counter flow heat exchanger, can it be like this? Can it be like this instead of concave, convex? Can it be combination of concave, convex, 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 concave, concave? Can it be? Yes, it can be. Then, but who is deciding this convexity or concavity? It is the property variation. How does Cp vary with temperature? How does it vary? That is what is going to decide. There is nothing sacred about these two plots. There is nothing sacred about that. They need not be that way at all. They need not be that way at all. Who is going to decide this convexity and concavity is the functional property. Cp, how is it going to vary with temperature? As an exercise, take any fluid and take the variation of Cp with temperature, plot that with temperature, compute, take the heat load and compute this with the heat transfer coefficient in an Excel sheet. You can calculate that, you plot that, you will find this Cp. Cp functionality as temperature, and you will see that all sorts of concavities and convexities come into picture. Now, coming to your question, how in cross flow it is going to vary? It is neither going to be cross flow or parallel flow or counter flow. It is very difficult for me to sit down and plot. I have to sit down and do the experiments and plot. The question what you have asked is an open ended question. It is not having a closed form answer. We have to sit down and do the experiments. In particular, for the cross flow heat exchanger, what I have designed and fabricated and what I am testing. So, I cannot answer this question in a specific form that this is indeed the answer. There is no unique answer for this question. Over to you.
Next question is, sir, why efficiency has not been taken as a performance parameter in case of heat exchanger?
Why efficiency is not taken into account? We have taken only effectiveness. If you want, we can define effectiveness as efficiency only, no? Efficiency is effectiveness only, no? That is the maximum heat transfer you could do, and what is the heat transfer you have gained is effectiveness, that is efficiency. Only thing is that instead of taking effectiveness, instead of calling it as efficiency, we are calling it as effectiveness, that is all.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, NIT 3G, any questions quickly?
Sir, while determining the boiler efficiency, basically boiler is a heat exchanger. So, how to calculate the radiation loss in a boiler, sir? Over to you, sir.
As it was,
question is how to calculate the efficiency of, how to calculate the radiation losses in a boiler?
So, between the fluids, there is no heat loss due to radiation. Okay. So, it is only from the outer surface of the fluid to the
outer wall of the boiler
to the environment. So, if you know the temperature roughly of the outer wall of the boiler, you can calculate the
HA into T wall minus T infinity plus sigma epsilon A into T wall to the power of 4 minus T infinity to the power of 4. That means I need to know the heat transfer coefficient, which is natural convection, 10, emissivity of the surface.
There was one tutorial problem of a plate suspended in air where you are asked to find the cooling rate where radiation and convection was there, exactly the same thing.
Now you understand reflectivity why it should be there, because emissivity has to be low and radiation loss has to be less. That is why we put aluminium foil.
Sir, while designing the heat exchangers, so how to incorporate this radiative heat transfer coefficient in the formulation?
Okay, question is how to incorporate radiative heat transfer in heat exchangers. Let us say, okay, everyone is asking this question. I thought I have answered this question, but let us draw that. Let us draw. Where is the energy going from where to where? Let us keep track of that. If where is the energy going? I have outer fluid, I have inner fluid, and this is my thickness of my wall, okay, this is my counterflow, okay. So, now where is the heat transfer going from the hot fluid to the cold fluid? Let me assume that this is hot and this is cold, which is what we usually do. This is, now where is the heat transfer taking place and what are the modes of the heat transfer? We have conduction, convection, radiation. Conduction and convection we have explained already. Can radiation take place?
Between the fluids.
Between the fluids. Where is the radiation taking place? Between the fluids. From this fluid to this fluid, is there any radiative heat transfer? No. From this wall to the fluid, there is no, because fluid is not participating. So, there is no radiative heat transfer between the fluids, but the radiative heat transfer is there from outer wall to the outer atmosphere. That is all it is, that is all it is, okay. So, there is, so it is valid to assume, not to consider radiation in any of our analysis, is that okay?
Okay, thank you, sir, over to you.
Okay. Mufakkam College.
How do we fix the two fluid and the shell fluid, sir?
Okay, how does one fluid, one fix the tube fluid and the shell fluid? Okay, so this is, there is no one unique way to say that this is the fluid always has to be in shell and this is the fluid always has to be in tube. There is no unique way. Okay. See, typically tube side heat transfer coefficients are larger than the shell side heat transfer coefficients, and tube side they are more or less uniform, and shell side you have lots of non-uniformities. So, you will use typically that fluid which will give you higher heat transfer coefficient on the shell side, which will give the higher heat transfer coefficient, and whichever fluid gives the lower heat transfer coefficient is put in the
tube side.
When I say which fluid which gives the lower heat transfer coefficient, who will decide me? That is coming from Nusselt number. Nusselt equal to Re to the power of something, Pr to the power of something. Whichever is having higher Pr usually will have higher K, okay? Will have higher K, usually will have higher K. So, higher Prandtl numbers usually are put on the shell side, on the tube side, lower Prandtl number fluids are put, for the simple reason that tube side heat transfer coefficient is higher than the shell side heat transfer coefficient, but not always. This is just generally thumb rule. Sometimes shell side also can be high. If my shell side flow rate is higher than the tube flow rate, then shell side heat transfer coefficient also can be high. That's why I said in any heat exchanger, there is no unique answer for all these questions, which tube should, which fluid should be, which side, what should be the diameter, what should be the length, there is, and which heat exchanger I will use under which circumstances, it is very difficult to answer. If you have to take typically tube in tube heat exchanger, we stop at 10 kilowatts, after 6 megawatts, sorry, what is that number, 20 kilowatts, up to 20 kilowatts only you will take tube in tube heat exchanger. After that, the length becomes too big, you cannot handle. So, you will have to go for shell and tube heat exchanger, okay.
Sir, assuming the constant heat flux on the hot fluid side, how do we analyze the heat exchangers?
Okay, how does one analyze a heat exchanger assuming a constant heat flux range? Take the appropriate heat transfer coefficient for the constant heat flux range. If it is turbulent, it does not matter whether it is constant heat flux or constant wall temperature. In turbulent, we have stated in convective heat transfer, no matter what is the boundary condition, my heat transfer coefficient is going to be independent of the boundary condition. So, it simply does not matter whether it is constant heat flux or constant wall temperature, if my boundary condition, if my flow is turbulent. Okay. One more question from the center quickly.
Hello sir, I have a question on convection, sir. H does not depend on Q and temperature difference in phase convection, it depends on only heat properties, is it same for free convection?
Okay, so what is the question I understand? In forced convection, we said that heat transfer coefficient is independent of heat flux and temperature difference. Is it true in free convection? I emphasized this point. In free convection, you see what is in free convection, heat transfer coefficient is dependent on what? Grashof number and Prandtl number. What is Grashof number dependent on? Grashof number is dependent on G beta delta T L cube divided by alpha nu. What is sitting in Grashof number? Delta T. That means heat transfer coefficient is dependent on delta T in case of natural convection. If it is constant heat flux, I will define Grashof number in terms of constant heat flux. So, in free convection, heat transfer coefficient is dependent on delta T or heat flux.
How does a thermal camera different from pyrometer?
How does a thermal camera different from pyrometer? Okay, I will simplify. I will tell this in a very simple manner. There are complicated answers for this. I am not going to give all complicated answers. Thermal pyrometer and thermal camera are same. Let us take it like that. There are some optical pyrometers. Let's not worry about them. Let us not complicate the answer. There are other pyrometers which work on optics. Let's not get into that. Generally, thermal camera is considered as optical probe. Thermal camera is pyrometer. Pyrometer means what? Pyro means temperature, meter means measure, measurement of temperature. Anything which measures temperature is a pyrometer. So, thermal camera is a pyrometer. For that matter, thermocouple is also a pyrometer, thermometer is also a pyrometer. Enough time. Okay, VIT Pune.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is related with heat transfer augmentation. Whenever we are augmenting the heat with the help of using some mechanical inserts, there is always an increase in heat transfer coefficient, but at the cost of pressure drop. Pressure drop we are measuring in terms of friction factor. In the due course of time, you have explained the one term that is called as enhancement ratio or enhancement factor to justify the use of that particular insert in that application. So that factor is something Nusselt number upon Nusselt number without insert divided by F upon F0 raised to 1 by 3. Can you illustrate how that 1 by 3 factor is actually coming?
Okay. Actually, it is little involved. Actually, I would request, the question asked is for enhancement factor, for enhancement, it is said that you take nu by nu naught upon F by F naught to the power of 1 by 3. It is a quite a lengthy derivation. All that I would say is for both the cases, for smooth and rough, all that what we are saying is constant pumping power. Constant pumping power. For the constant pumping power, it turns out that V to the power of 3 V to the power of 3 turns out to be F by F naught to the power of 1 by 3. Please put this question in Moodle. I will answer this through Moodle. It cannot be answered that straightforward manner. It will take at least 10 minutes time. Please bear with me. Please put this in Moodle. I will answer this.
Okay, thank you, sir. Over to you.
Yeah. Okay. Nirma University, Ahmedabad.
So, in a baffled heat shell and tube heat exchanger, how we can calculate heat transfer coefficient?
Okay. See, I told, my question is, how does one calculate the heat transfer coefficient in baffled shell and tube heat exchanger? Professor, I told this in the morning. There is an elaborate procedure in Bell-Delaware method.
Some 20 steps are there.
20 to 30 steps are there. They are all given in Hewitt. But if you still insist that you want, we have that notes in Bell-Delaware method. Please put this question in Moodle. We will upload that notes. Okay? It's a very elaborate 20. It will run to 20, 30 pages if I have to write that
and,
here.
And with a lot
I don't remember also. Okay? So please put it across that question. Definitely, I will put up that in Moodle. Okay? Please refer to Hewitt more than my notes. Hewitt is the right textbook. Okay?
One more question is there.
Hello, sir. In case of domestic LPG stoves, there must be some radiation losses. So, can we put say D-shape seals to avoid those radiation losses?
No, I said, see.
Will it be fruitful?
Question is, will there be radiation losses in case of LPG flame? See, I have told LPG flame doesn't have emissivity. So, emissivity is not there means there is no radiation from the flame to myself. Okay? So, there is no radiation losses. At the most, you might be feeling little bit of heat because there is a vessel sitting on it. The vessel has got heated up and vessel it is having emissivity and that is radiating heat to us. If I put a small tumbler and eat it, I will not feel heat. If I put a big boiler for heating water, then I will feel the heat. Not because from the radiation from the flame, but because of the radiation from the plate. So, that is the answer for your question. Okay.
Yes, sir. I am talking about the radiation from the vessel itself. Can we reduce the radiation losses from the vessel so that the heat transfer can be enhanced?
Heat loss is reduced. How to reduce the heat loss from the vessel to the human being? Yes, answer is in putting thermal shield. If one puts an asbestos thermal shield around it, I don't see the heat transfer. Because my asbestos sheet takes long time before it reaches high temperature, by that time my cooking is over.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Over. I think we are coming to the end of the session and we are stopping this.